السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته وأهلا بكم في حلقة جديدة من برنامج شاهد على العصر، حيث نواصل الاستماع إلى شهادة الدكتور مهاتير محمد رئيس الوزراء الماليزي. أيتم مهاتير، مرحبا بك.
Thank you.
في 18 من يناير عام 2018 قرر تحالف المعارضة الماليزية المكون من 4 أحزاب ترشيحك لرئاسة الحكومة في الانتخابات البرلمانية التي قررت في ذلك الوقت. ما الذي كان يعنيه هذا الأمر بالنسبة إليك؟
Well, we find that the government of the Prime Minister of that time, Nagib Razak, was doing a lot of harm to the country. I could not think about a way to stop him from doing that other than by defeating him in elections. But to do that, I need to work with the opposition because my party alone would never be able to defeat the incumbent government. So I decided that between working with the opposition and allowing Najib to continue with his depredations, it is far better that I work with the opposition because the opposition is not as bad as Dato' Sri Najib's administration. Therefore, I decided to work with the opposition for this purpose only.
السؤال المهم الذي يعني تكرر كثيرا في وسائل الإعلام هو كيف استطعت أن تجمع 4 أحزاب متباينة ربما في مواقفها من بينها حزب صيني؟
The fact is that the other opposition parties had tried before and failed to defeat Dato' Sri Najib. That was because there was no support from the Malay population, Malay voters of the country. I believe I had their support, and therefore, if I joined them, I would bring in Malay voters, and that will enable them to win the election. At the same time, we have to have the support of the Chinese voters. So we need to work with the DAP, irrespective of what we feel about the past opposition by the DAP against my government.
ما هي الأهداف المشتركة لهذه الأحزاب الأربعة التي كانت في المعارضة التي جمعتها التي جعلتها تجتمع على هدف واحد؟
Well, if the 4 opposition parties, including my own party, were to work together, then we will have both the Malay support because of my party and Chinese support because of the DAP. With these 4 parties getting the support of all the different communities in Malaysia, the chances of winning are much better.
لكن نجيب رزاق كان في ذروة قوته في ذلك الوقت وكان يبدو من خلال جهاز الدولة الذي أسسته أنت أنه الحاكم الذي لا يقهر.
In fact, his party has never been defeated even when I was the head of that party. The Malays, the indigenous Malays, always support his party. But what he was doing was damaging to the country and even to the Malays. However, because of their support for him, he felt very strong. The important thing is how to break that support. And I believe that as I was before regarded as a leader of the Malays, that my joining the opposition would take away some of his support, enough for us to win the election.
ما هي أهم التحديات التي كانت أمامكم أنتم كأحزاب معارضة في مواجهة حزب أمنه الذي لم يهزم قط في انتخابات سابقة منذ استقلال ماليزيا؟
Of course, the opposition party has no power, whereas the government has got the power and authority over the instruments of government, the institutions of the government, including, of course, the police and the legal services. They can abuse those power they have in order to block the opposition. In fact, what they did was to deregister my party so that I could not participate as a party in the election. They also prevented us from forming a coalition because our party cannot join the coalition because it has been deregistered, and therefore the coalition cannot be created. This means that we have to fight as individual parties, and this would mean that we will lose the election.
هو حل الحزب الذي ترأسه في 6 إبريل 2018 ولكن أنتم تمكنتم من العودة بقرار من المحكمة. نيويورك تايمز نشرت تقريرا في 12 يناير 2018 قالت إن اختيار المعارضة للدكتور مهاتير محمد لقيادة الانتخابات يبدو أمرا غريبا وشككت في قدرتك على الفوز والعودة إلى السلطة مرة أخرى.
Well, our party was deregistered and we couldn't form the coalition government. What we did was to agree to use one of the parties which are still legal, one of the opposition parties, the Justice Party was still legal. And we used their flag and their symbol as if we were members of the party. But the people generally know that we are not members of that party. We are simply making use of that party in order to present a united front.
ربما يتساءل الكثيرون الناس تتقاعد في سن 60 وأنت كنت في 93 يعني أمد الله في عمرك وقررت أن تعود إلى السياسة مرة أخرى.
My age.
Yes.
Yes, I was already 92 years old at that time, but I was still able to function. And the thing is that many groups of people, including the opposition parties, asked me to come back and lead the party. So it is because of the people asking me to come back that I came back. On my own, I would rather retire.
لكنك لم تكن متقاعدا حينما يعني زرتك وأنت قبل الانتخابات كنت تعمل من السابعة صباحا وحتى السادسة مساء ولا زلت تقوم بهذا إلى اليوم.
Yes, I have been used to working since I started life as a medical doctor, and a medical doctor does not have any free time. I have been used to getting up late at night to attend to my patients. So working hard is something that I'm used to.
اسمح لي أيضا ربما يسأل كثير من الناس أنت الآن أكبر زعماء العالم سنا وتعمل ربما 12 ساعة في اليوم هل يمكن أن تخبر المشاهدين عن السر الذي تحتفظ به والذي يمكنك من القيام بهذا العمل الشاق وأنت ما شاء الله في هذا السن؟
There is really no secret. If you are not attacked by some diseases that are debilitating, like having cancer or a stroke or something, you are relatively healthy. The best thing that you can do is to lead a healthy life, which means, of course, you are very careful about your weight, you don't eat too much, you do some exercise, and generally you keep on being active in life, because if you rest and you remain inactive, then the body responds to that by getting weaker. For example, your muscles. If you don't use your muscles, the muscles become weak. So it is good to use your muscles because then they will remain strong. The same with the brain. If you don't use your brain for some time, you'll forget words, you'll forget faces, etc. So I believe in being very active as long as I can, and that keeps me, I think, relatively healthy and able to function.
أدام الله عليك نعمة الصحة والعافية وآمل أن تكون هذه نصائح لكل من يتابعنا. كانت الانتخابات مقررة في شهر أغسطس، لكن نجيب رزاق أصدر قرارا في 5 إبريل 2018 بحل البرلمان، واختار 9 من مايو 2018 تاريخا لإجراء الانتخابات. هل كانت هذه فترة كافية؟
Well, he thought that we will not be prepared for the election because immediately before that he deregistered my party and prevented us from having a coalition. Besides that, of course, all sources of funds were blocked by him so that we were a very poor coalition. And the election needs a lot of money for all the activities incurred during the election. So that is why he suddenly announced that the election would be held. And it is going to be held, the polling day is fixed on in the middle of the week. Normally, polling day should be at the end of the week during the weekend's holidays. But he fixed it in the middle, which means that many of our people who are working would not be able to vote. All kinds of obstruction were thrown in our way in order to ensure that we would fail.
هل كانت لدى نجيب رزاق خطط من أجل إفشالكم في الانتخابات؟
Certainly he did. What he did was to instruct every department in the government, including the election commission, which was supposed to be independent. It was he who fixed the dates for the election so that it will cause us to have difficulties in getting support from the voters.
في المقابل ما هي خططكم لإفشال خطته والفوز في الانتخابات؟
We believe that if we expose all the wrong things that he had done during his period, including losing money and stealing money from the government, the people would support us.
أنت تقدمت في دائرة لنكاوي مسقط رأسك للترشح في 28 إبريل. في الانتخابات كان من المقرر أن يشارك 15 مليون ناخب، سينتخبون 222 نائبا برلمانيا و505 من أعضاء المجالس الإقليمية. على كم نائب كنت تراهن للفوز من أجل تشكيل الحكومة؟
Well, we need to win at least 112 members before we can form the government. But our thinking is that we would not be able to do that. But in the event, because the support of the people was so overwhelming that we won more than 112. It's entirely the people's choice.
هل كان لفضيحة الصندوق السيادي تأثير على الانتخابات مكنكم من الفوز؟
Yes, very much so. We explained that he created one MDB so that he could borrow huge sums of money, 42 billion Malaysian ringgit. The government is not allowed to borrow that big sum of money. But by forming a company, the company borrowed, but then the government has been asked to guarantee the loan. Effectively, it was the government which was borrowing. And in fact, today when the one MDB failed, the government has to take over the loans. And we are now saddled with huge amounts of money which has been lost.
سأأتي بالتفصيل إلى فضيحة الصندوق السيادي، لكن هذه هي المرة الأولى التي يهزم فيها حزب أمنه بعد أن بدأ يحكم ماليزيا منذ العام 57. ما هي الأسباب التي أدت إلى هزيمته؟
أمنو was the party that won independence for our country. It has been very popular. It had been led by five prime ministers, during which the indigenous Malays supported it fully, giving in victory at every election, including the 13th election. But this is the 14th election. But between the 13th and 14th election, Najib did all kinds of wrong things. Particularly, it was reported in the foreign press that he stole government money by the billions. So even though it was a popular party, the leadership was bad, and the people recognized that it is no longer the party that was created to win elections. It has become a party that has been abused by the leaders.
في تجمع انتخابي لك في الأول من مايو عام 2018 قلت إن أكبر خطأ ارتكبته في حياتي هو اختيار نجيب رزاق وأنا أعمل الآن ما في وسعي من أجل تصحيح هذا الخطأ. هل أخطأت في اختيار نجيب رزاق وحده أم أيضا أخطأت في اختيار عبد الله بدوي أيضا؟
Well, he was a good minister at the time when he was in my cabinet. He performed very well, but of course I didn't know about what his misdeeds are because I was not informed. And I thought that being the son of the first, the second prime minister, who was very much idolized by the people because of his good performance, I thought that the son would be as good or something like the father. So I chose him on that basis. It was only after I had chosen him and he had become prime minister that he did all these things, which is openly against all the morally right things to do.
منذ العام 1965 وأنت تشارك في الانتخابات البرلمانية، ما الذي شكلته انتخابات العام 2018 بالنسبة إليك؟
This is a very important election. In the when I first went stood for election, I had no doubt that the party was very popular and I would win. And indeed, I won all the elections I led, five elections that I led with two-thirds majority, because the people were very supportive of the party. But it changed, of course, when they find that the party, the leader of the party, was using his position in order to steal money from the government.
خصومك السياسيين يتهموك بأنك قسمت المالي بينك وبين حزب أمنه كما مكنت الصينيين من أن يدخلوا مناطق المالي عبر تحالفك مع الحزب الصيني.
Well, even when I was leading AMNO before, which was a Malay party, I did get Chinese support. But this time around, the Chinese were very unhappy with the performance of the Najib government, and they too would want him to be overthrown. And so they gave full support. Maybe it is because they want Najib to be overthrown, even if they may have some doubts about my leadership.
ما أثر التركيبة العرقية في ماليزيا والتي تتكون من المالي السكان الأصليين والصينيين والهنود الذين جلبهم البريطانيون إلى ماليزيا خلال سنوات احتلالها، ما أثر هذه التركيبة العرقية على الانتخابات والعملية السياسية في ماليزيا؟
Well, we are a multiracial country. We have three major races, Malays, Chinese, and Indians. The unfortunate thing is that they are not only different because of their race, but also in terms of economic performance. The Chinese are much better off and have become very well off in Malaysia. The Malays are still very backward and poor. And as we all know, disparity between rich and poor has always been a cause for a conflict between the rich and the poor. That is why we have socialism, for example, because the workers were unhappy with the disparity in terms of their earning and the capitalists. And the same thing happened in Russia because of the rich being extremely rich while the poor were extremely poor. So in Malaysia, the disparity in the wealth between the races is something that has to be reduced if we are going to have a stable and peaceful country.
السؤال هو هل يمكن لحزبك أو للتحالف الذي تقوده الآن والمكون من الملي والصينيين أن يبدأ عملية انصهار في المجتمع الماليزي في ظل ما نشر في كريستيان سينس مونيتور في نهاية يوليو 2018 إلى أن الماليزيين لا يعرفون إلا النذر اليسير عن ديانات وأعراق بعضهم البعض المالي منكفئون على أنفسهم الهنود على أنفسهم الصينيون على أنفسهم
Well, ethnicity, of course, race, of course, divide people. But here, the division is not only because of race, but also in terms of economic wealth, in terms of religion, the Malays being Muslim, the Chinese being Buddhist, and the Indians being Hindus. Also, our cultures are different. Our languages are different. So the ruling Malaysia is made very difficult because of these differences. If it is a single ethnic country, it will be more easy to overcome the differences, say, between rich and poor.
لو عدت للحملة الانتخابية في إبريل 2018 هل شعرت في بعض الأوقات أنك يمكن أن تفشل في الفوز في الانتخابات؟
I felt we could lose the election because Najib was very powerful. He was in control of the government. He can take action to, for example, deregister our party. And there are lots of things that he can do with the power of government. We were helpless. We couldn't do anything. All we could do is to appeal to the authorities, but there was not enough time for the authorities to act.
ما هي أجهزة الدولة التي كان يستخدمها نجيب من أجل أن يفوز وأن تخسره؟
Well, Najib, of course, knew that if he loses the election, he is likely to be charged in court for many wrong things that he has done. So I was one of the principal critics against him. So for that reason, although we were friends before, and he was a minister in my government, because of the fear that if he loses, he would be in great trouble. Therefore, he has done everything possible to prevent me from winning.
حينما رجعت إلى وسائل الإعلام العالمية التي تناولت الانتخابات الماليزية في ذلك الوقت لم يكن هناك شك ولو بنسبة 1% أن نجيب رزاق يمكن أن يخسر الانتخابات فكيف خسر نجيب رزاق الانتخابات؟
Well, I think our campaign was effective in explaining the wrong things that Najib had done. It is the people's decision to overthrow him also. It's not our party's decision alone. It is the people, basically it is the people, through their votes, they want to overthrow the Najib government.
الانتخابات أجريت في 9 مايو عام 2018. أعلنت النتائج في اليوم الثاني 10 مايو. وفوجئ الجميع بأن تحالف الأمل الذي تقوده حقق النسبة الأكبر في الانتخابات بينما خسرت أمنه خسارة فادحة وحصلت على 79 مقعد فقط. ما الذي شكله الأمر بالنسبة إليك؟
Well, AMNO was my party before. I was a president of the party. I was a prime minister of AMNO for 22 years. But that was to me a different AMNO. AMNO that was dedicated to servicing the people, to growing the country. But under the UMNO, under Najib, is quite different. Was quite different. He concentrated more on his own enjoyment of a good life, and he actually stole money, and he and his wife were involved in things that were known to the people to be wrong.
الجارديان البريطانية في عدد 12 مايو قالت إن من المدهش في الانتخابات الماليزية هو أن حكومة نجيب رزاق التي أدمنت الوسائل القذرة قد سلمت الحكم بسهولة.
Yes, we felt that he would not want to hand over the government if the margin of winning was small, like one or two members. I think he may do something to prevent me from taking over as a government. He will not hand over the government to me. But he lost by a very big number of votes, number of seats. It was difficult for him to deny that. So in the end, of course, he tried to form a coalition with another party, the Islamic Party, but there were not enough for them to form a government. So in the end, he had to give in.
كل إمكانات الدولة كانت في يد نجيب رزاق. لماذا لم يزور الانتخابات؟
Well, he did. Actually, for example, in one instance, a person who is quite eligible to contest was prevented from contesting because he forgot some document. And in another case, a person who was eligible to contest was declared as not eligible because of being fined a sum of less than 2,000. Actually, if he had been fined more than 2,000, then of course he may not be able to be a candidate. But even with less than 2,000, he was prevented. And there were many other cases where the counting was not done properly. But despite all those things, the number of seats we won was so big that even if they win all those other seats, it's not enough to deny us our majority.
الصحافة العالمية وصفت فوزك بأنه تسونامي سياسي في ماليزيا. فبماذا تصف أنت هذا الفوز؟
Well, I think this time around we would call it a tsunami because we didn't expect such overwhelming support. But it is the feeling of the people. The people really do not want to see Najib continue as the Prime Minister of Malaysia. It's not so much UMNO, it is the leadership of UMNO.
رغم انتقادك الشديد للمالي واتهامهم بالكسل وكتبت كتابا عن هذا الأمر هو كتاب المعضلة الماليزية لكن المالي يحبوك وأعادوا انتخابك مرة أخرى ما السر في هذا؟
Yeah, well, I think I was Prime Minister for 22 years. I won 5 elections. I led 5 elections and I won them with a big majority. That means that people must appreciate the things that I did when I was Prime Minister. I think it is that appreciation which enabled me to draw away from Najib some of the support which, as Prime Minister, he got. I think some people remembered what I have done, perhaps, and they decided that they should defeat Najib and bring me back.
هل كان لديك شكوك في ألا يكلفك الملك محمد الخامس بتشكيل الحكومة لذلك قلت تصريحك الشهير لا خيار للملك سوى تكليفي بمنصب رئيس الوزراء؟
Yeah, but it is obvious that although there was no coalition, I had the support of the majority of the members of parliament. The rule is that to be a prime minister, you must have the support of the majority of the members of parliament, not the party. It may be coming from many parties, but if you have a majority, then you are entitled to be appointed by the king.
أديت اليمين الدستورية رئيسا للوزراء في 10 مايو 2018 وعدت لقيادة ماليزيا وأنت في 92 لتكون أكبر زعيم سياسي منتخب في العالم.
Well, I never really dreamed of being prime minister again, and never dreamt that I would become prime minister at the age of 93. But the fact is that this happened. This is the wish of the people. And I suppose if Allah wish me to be, I would still be healthy enough to become prime minister.
الإيكونوميست البريطانية في 10 مايو 2018 علقت على فوزك قائلة إن فوز الدكتور مهاتير محمد يعني أنه سيعود لتنظيف ماليزيا والحزب الحاكم أمنه من الفساد.
أمنه would be killed, yes, because it has done something wrong. It has supported a leader who was doing something wrong. The people were less supportive of أمنه. And after the election, after we had won, many of the UMNO members left the party and became independent. Some even joined our party. They stayed with UMNO because UMNO, they fear the leadership. They were afraid of Najib, who might do something to them if they don't support. Also, he was bribing them in a very big way, so they feel comfortable to be with UMNO during Najib's time, and they really never expected that UMNO would lose. But in the end, of course, after UMNO has lost, they left the party.
هل تعتقد أن UMNO يمكن أن يستعيد قوته مرة أخرى أم أن هذه فترة تاريخية وانتهت؟ والناس الآن تبحث عن من يحقق مصالحها وليس عن الانتماء إلى أمنه.
I don't think it will come back. The thing is that once you have lost, once you have shown your bad deeds, people will not come back to you. They will split. They may still exist as a very minor party. That happens to almost all parties which won independence among the colonies of the British and the Europeans. Once the winning party loses the support of the people, it will not come back.
ما هي المكاسب الحقيقية التي حققها الماليزيون من وراء إعادتك إلى السلطة وأنت في 92 أو في 93 من عمرك؟
Obviously, the new government is formed by people who were for 60 years in the opposition. Without me, this will be a government which is not familiar with the role of the government, the ways of the government. Maybe they will take time, but initially they will have difficulties in adjusting from being the opposition to being the government. But my being there as Prime Minister has enabled me to give some of my past experience to the new government. So in that sense, my being there does serve some purpose.
كيف وجدت السلطة حينما عدت إليها بعد 15 عاما بعيدا عنها؟
It is quite different. It's not as if like when I became Prime Minister in 1981. But here I have to meet with a lot of hostile people, not only politicians, even among the civil servants. They were quite hostile. So I had to deal with this problem. So this time around, it is a very tough for me, even with 22 years of experience as Prime Minister, it's still very difficult for me to make adjustment to make use of the authority of the Prime Minister, because some things are not may not be done the way I wanted it to be done.
ما هي أهم الصعوبات التي وجدتها في الفرق ما بين توليك السلطة في العام 1981 وعودتك إلى السلطة مرة أخرى في العام 2018؟
In 1981, the government was intact. It was functioning. I don't have to make adjustments. I don't have to change anything. But this time around, I have to face a country that is almost bankrupt because of the borrowings. And then I find that some of the civil servants had been subverted by Najib. And they, they can be charged for corruption, etc. I had to get rid of people I suspect were corrupt. I had also to change the people who were definitely loyal to the previous government and did not seem willing to work under the new government. So there were a lot of difficulties in the way. I had practically to rebuild the administrative machinery.
رغم أنك كنت تتابع كل شيء لم تكن بعيدا عن أوضاع الدولة ولكن ما هي الملفات الصعبة التي صدمتك حينما دخلت إلى مكتب رئيس الحكومة ووجدتها؟
All the things that were done wrong has got to be righted by me and people come and expect things to be done immediately but it's not possible. For example, we cannot give out money the way Najib was giving money. He was trying to bribe the people by giving them government money for free. But we don't have the money. The money has been stolen. And the government revenue is not enough for us to keep on giving people money for free. We have to reduce the amount of money given. And of course, people feel unhappy because of that.
هل واجهت صدمة من ملف معين؟
Oh yes. What we suspected was nothing compared with the reality. The amount of money lost was much bigger than we thought. The undermining of subversion of the government machinery was very extensive. And we find that many people remain loyal to Najib despite all the things that has been revealed about his wrongdoings.
ما هي الاستراتيجية التي وضعتها لمواجهة هذا الملف المليء بالفساد؟
Well, we strengthened the anti-corruption agency, gave it more power, and we are very intolerant of any sign of corruption. We will take action against them. And of course, the new government members, they are from the opposition. They have always been against corruption. And so far, we have not found any of the new ministers being corrupt. But the civil servants who were corrupt have all been removed.
ما هو أول قرار وقعته حينما عدت إلى مكتب رئيس الحكومة؟
Well, we announced the formation of the anti-corruption agency, and we decided to do away, we nullified the laws which were very oppressive of the people.
أما تعتقد أن عدم وجود حرية صحافة كافية في ماليزيا هي التي مكنت الفاسدين في الدولة من ذلك؟
When they knew they were going to lose, they destroyed a lot of documents. They hide many of the money that they have taken. So immediate action depends upon our investigators. The investigation took a long time to discover what was wrong. Before that, we could not act. On certain laws, we can abolish them just by declaring that the laws will not be applied anymore. But even then, we need to change the laws through parliament. And that means a long time for parliament to sit and to decide what laws to do away with, what laws to amend, what laws that needs to be modified, etc. All these things takes time. Even after 1.5 years, we still have not been able to change some of the laws, because these laws require amendment to the Constitution. And amendment to the Constitution involves support by 2/3 of Parliament, and we don't have 2/3. So it's difficult for us to carry out our promises.
الكل يقول أن القضاء في ماليزيا، النظام القضائي في ماليزيا بحاجة إلى إصلاح، وهذا يتضح في محاكمة نجيب الآن. يجلس في بيته قرير العين وهو متهم بسرقة المليارات وإفساد الحياة في ماليزيا.
Well, we have made a promise that there should be a separation of powers between the legislative, the executive, and the judiciary. Whatever the judiciary does, we cannot interfere. If we interfere and tell the judiciary to hurry up, for example, that is interference, and that means that the judiciary is not independent. So when the judiciary is independent and they make decisions as to when to hear the case, or they may delay because of certain reasons, we have no power to intervene. That is what we promise to do, that the judiciary is independent. Whether it does the right thing or the wrong thing, we just cannot do anything. During the time of Najib, the rules and the laws were there. He simply ignored the rules. He abused his power. I have now to go back to the practice of that we promised. For example, the separation of powers. I have promised to do that. Now I'm doing that. And in the first instance, when I was previously Prime Minister, there was no occasion for me to be involved in the executive, with the executive or the judiciary.
بعدما تركت السلطة في العام 2003، فقد الشعب الماليزي الثقة في الحكومة. جاء رئيس وزراء عبد الله بدوي واتهم بالفساد، وجاء بعده نجيب رزاق أكثر فسادا منه. ما هي الوسائل التي ستقوم بها من أجل إعادة ثقة الشعب الماليزي في الحكومة؟
Well, to show to the people that we obey the laws, that we obey the rule of law, for example, and also that we do not interfere with the executive and the judiciary. And in the end, of course, the performance of the country economically will regain the trust of the people.
ربما يكون ملف ديون ماليزيا هو من أكبر الملفات التي بين يديك. ما هو حجم الديون الذي تركت عليها ماليزيا في العام 2003 وحجم ديون ماليزيا اليوم؟
Huge. During my time, I seldom borrowed much money. We had enough money from the taxes to run the country. We only borrowed for certain projects, and we borrowed up to extent that we can repay what we borrow. But here in Najib's case, he has borrowed more than 1 trillion Malaysian ringgit. This is about 84%, about 84% of the GDP, whereas the limit that he can borrow is only 53% of the GDP. But he has gone beyond that.
التقارير تقول أنك حينما توليت السلطة في 2018 حجم ديون ماليزيا كان 252 مليار دولار. كيف نشأت وتراكمت هذه الديون خلال 15 عاما حتى بلغت هذا الحجم الضخم؟
Well, it is the decision made by Najib. What he wanted to do was to take some of the money, steal some of the money. But the government doesn't have enough money for him to steal. And he can borrow only a limited amount of money The government can only borrow a limited amount of money. What he did was to create a company, and that company borrowed. So that company is not limited by government rules. So he borrowed 42 billion Malaysian ringgit. This was never done before. And that 42 billion ringgit has now disappeared. We find that some of the money was used to buy property and a lot of things in order to launder the money. And some of the money we don't know where they are. So that borrowing was not for government use. That borrowing was not even for business. It was just to steal the money.
اسمح لي أتناول هذا الملف في الحلقة القادمة. Thank you very much. كما أشكركم مشاهدينا الكرام على حسن متابعتكم. في الحلقة القادمة إن شاء الله نواصل الاستماع إلى شهادة رئيس الوزراء الماليزي الدكتور مهاتير محمد. في الختام أنقل لكم تحية فريق البرنامج، وهذا أحمد منصور يحييكم، والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.